Welcome to our 2600 years journey that we're going to take together, a journey from us being the center of the universe and all we know to the pale blue dot, the grain of sand we're living on in the middle of nowhere. Due to the fact that I don't want to squeeze all that information into one short episode, we'll meet up for the next 2 weeks for our story time at Wonders of the Universe. Jump into the looking glass, into the past, and stay with me until we arrive in our present. It all started in Greece on a warm summer evening circa 600 BC. You finished your shopping at the local agora and you'd look up at the night sky and notice that some of the stars seem to move. So you name them Plantares or Wanderer. In the middle of the agora stands an old man named Thales of Miletus, talking about the sun, predicting its disappearance in some days on 28th of May 585 BC, marking this event as the first ever known predicted solar eclipse in human history and sparking the curiosity for space after the disappearance of the Mayan culture with all its astronomers and all their knowledge. Welcome to Babylon. The Kassites are ruling here and their curiosity is turning their view to the stars. Soon, astronomers start to map their discoveries and catalogue stars, dividing the fixed stars into three groups: Anu, Enlil, and Ea. Containing lists of constellations, individual stars and planets. Listing 18 constellations in the zodiac, from which 12 are still surviving among our modern constellations. Among other countries, the Greek borrowed the Babylonian zodiacs, and Plato might have gotten a hold of it. While searching further to get more answers, he founded the school Platonic Academy in Athena, the first university in the entire world, and without a fee to pay. It was promoting the idea of a universe moving in harmony and the sun, moon, and other planets moving around Earth in perfect circles. What a beautiful picture! But it didn't take them too long until another Greek stepped into the spotlight. And maybe he got the chance before to visit Plato's academy and walked underneath the entrance with a phrase: "Let none but geometers enter through this door." His name was Aristarchus of Samos, and for his time he had quite the unusual idea. He placed our sun in the middle of his model and promoted the idea of Earth and other planets moving around the sun. Again, we are talking about 2,300 years ago. He even went so far to provide first estimations of Earth-Sun distance with being 18 to 20 times further away than the Moon. Well, it actually is about 400 times that of the Moon, but this man didn't even have a telescope, and still he suspected the stars were other suns that are very far away. Still, as so often with great minds, he wasn't taken seriously. We are staying in Greece a little longer. Only 40 years after Aristarchus' death, another great personality got born. Make way for Hipparchus of Nicaea, the founder of trigonometry, the greatest astronomical observer or even all astronomer of the antique. He was one of the creators of the armillary sphere, the model of the sky. This will even play another role later in another episode, as even Kepler used this apparatus to measure the sky. And so did Hipparchus himself. He wrote down the accurate position over 850 of the brightest stars in a map and star catalog. This is pretty incredible. Almost around the same time in China, 4th century BC, Shi Shenfu created a celestial map of his own and catalogued 809 stars in 122 constellations. Human curiosity seems to be unstoppable, and the thirst for space, as many of us might know, is insatiable. Okay, it is still before Christ, and humanity already started very successfully to measure the stars and to grasp an idea on how our solar system might be working. And all even without having a telescope or having other big technological inventions. And then this happened. It is around 140. We're moving from Greece to Egypt now to find a man named Ptolemy. While some of his studies might have had a huge impact on medical studies, literary works, and music, well, his astrological impact was quite huge as well. At the age of 40, he presented, well, the Babylonian arithmetical techniques, Hipparchus geometric models. Yay! Back to geocentrical view again. I assume that is what can happen when Urania, the muse of astronomy, guides you and people believe that you're a Ptolemaic pharaoh ruling Egypt. Call me King Ptolemy, the pro-astrological authority of the highest magnitude. I am sorry if I offended someone. I didn't get to know this man. It's just, well, back to the disk as the center of the universe for the next 1500 years. Whew. Yeah. Well, let us just jump 2000 years forward real quick to glimpse at how far we've gotten and brace ourselves for the dark age of astronomy. And while taking a deep breath, click the thumbs up, subscribe, and continue this journey with me. Okay, from here on, nothing really happened for the next 700 years. But after a long period of stagnation, in 813, they founded a school of astronomy in Baghdad. And finally, around 830, Arabia had their first breakthrough with a major work of astronomy by Al-Khwarizmi, a Persian polymath. His work marked the turning point in Arabic astronomy and the beginning of non-traditional methods of studies and calculations. His work contained approximately 37 chapters on calendrical and astronomical calculations. And 116 tables, including the movements of the Sun, the Moon, and the, at the time, 5 known planets. Only around 100 years later, the first analog computer was built. No. Yeah, kind of. It was called Astrolabe and got constructed by mathematician-astronomer Mohamed Al-Fazari. It was used to precisely measure the positions of stars and planets. This astrolabe allowed Islamic astronomers to compile the back then most detailed almanacs and star atlases. I watched some videos and pictures about astrolabes, read some articles and the instructions, and yeah, I would really love to have one. This thing definitely made it on my Christmas wish list for this year. We finally reached the year 1030, when astronomers started to discuss heliocentric theories again. Well, for a short time. The mathematician and astronomer Al-Biruni, who was studying the moving of the Earth, stated, you know, very casual, that the Earth as center wouldn't cause any mathematical problems. Case dismissed. Let's quickly head back to India, to a man called Bhaskara II. Of course, a mathematician astronomer, calculating longitudes and latitudes of planets, lunar and solar eclipses, rising and settings, moons, lunar crescent, syzygies and conjunctions of the planets with each other and with the fixed stars. Wow. Plus, explaining the three problems of diurnal rotation, the apparent motion of the celestial objects. Then they just continue to calculate the planetary mean motion, ellipses, first visibility of the planets, the lunar crescent, the seasons, and the length of the Earth's revolution around the sun to 9 decimal places, being 23 hours, 56 minutes, and 4.09. This was the beginning of our journey. I hope you liked it. And if you didn't get what I just said, remember to tune in next week for some easier to understand explanations. So, would you like to know more? What about Copernicus, Newton, and Messier? And when do I finally present and explain everything we know about our position in the universe? Tune in next week to further explore with me the deep space of our universe.